Hello everyone, Treecks here, and welcome to my newest project. Let's return to Donkey Kong, because there's a lot of games from this era that need to be covered. Therefore, they're going to be a little bit close together, but still, the next one is coming up. Welcome to Donkey Kong Land, the Game Boy iteration of the Donkey Kong Country formula that Rare created in mid-90s, and thought, might as well try to put this on the handheld systems as well. So, they took their style of graphics, they took their style of gameplay, and translated that to the 8-bit black and white handheld system, the Game Boy. For the most part, it is the same as the Donkey Kong Country series, the only major difference being it is on the Game Boy instead of the SNES. Therefore, it is a little bit downgraded compared to the Donkey Kong Country series. There's no other way for that. The Game Boy is just not able to do the things the SNES can do. But still, Rare decided it needs to be on handheld systems too. And story-wise, it's mostly the same as the Donkey Kong Country games as well. In fact, this game actually has the story of after the Donkey Kong Country events happened, Cranky Kong was not impressed with Donkey and Diddy's adventure, said, yeah, you only were able to do it because of it being on a fancy system. There's no way you can do it in an 8-bit adventure. So he arranged King K. Rool to steal the banana horde again. So Donkey Kong and Diddy Kong are now forced to do an 8-bit adventure trying to beat the Kremlings. Funny story. We're breaking a lot of fourth borders here. But yeah, it's basically Donkey Kong Country, but on the Game Boy. Okay, file select screen. Let's pretend that is not something special, because it isn't. But anyway, let's not think that this is a carbon copy of Donkey Kong Country, that this is just a port of that game. This game actually is not. I know later Donkey Kong Land games do it that way, but this game actually has original worlds, original levels, and is therefore really a completely different game. Let's go to Jungle Jaunt, which is the first level in this game. Controls are the same as in Donkey Kong Country. You run around with the D-pad. You can roll with B in this case. You can jump with A. Those are all the things we know. Duck with the down button. Okay, first things first. A new token gets introduced in this game. These are Donkey and Diddy tokens, or just Kong tokens. These can be used in bonuses later on. More on that later, because we don't really have the context for that right now, but they will be used in bonuses. And besides that, we have the regular enemies we know, the slippers, the critters, and the bananas to collect, of course. 100 for a 1-up. They're going to be spread everywhere. And you can already see what this game is about. It is basically Donkey Kong Country, just... They really just already get hit. Just on a Game Boy system instead. And yeah, me being hit so early is the next thing I can talk about. Control-wise, this game is supposed to be the same as Donkey Kong Country. However, this is also being affected by the 8-bit system. There's only limited memory, so therefore the controls also feel a little bit different. There's a bonus here, by the way. In some instances, you can find these patches in the ground that can have some ropes in them. And climb these ropes in order to find bonuses. Just like in Donkey Kong Country, get all bonuses in every level to 100% this game. Animal friends also make a return, in this case Rambi. Not all of the animal buddies are present in this game though. I believe Rambi and Expresso are the only ones who are present in this game. This is a checkpoint. This is the save your progress in the level in case you die. The midway point, called whatever you like. They look like this in this game. Okay, another bonus in here. I'm already tripping over all of my words, because a lot of things are happening at once. This game is quite compact. That's the reason I am covering it as a weekend project. It is not the biggest game in the world. Ow. Controls. I need to get used to them. But yeah, there's another thing you can see in this game. Because of the limited memory, they decided not to have both Kongs on screen at the same time. You actually switch Kongs separately. Only one of them is on screen at the moment. Okay, this is the end of the stage. Collecting all the Kong letters in this game does not give you a 1-up like in Donkey Kong Country. It gives you the opportunity to save your game. Pretty awesome, actually. That's a pretty neat trick, actually. And 100%ing a stage, just like in Donkey Kong Country, goes with these exclamation points. There's no level names on screen, so they do it like this. There's an exclamation point beside the dot that indicates the level. That's how it works here. Okay, the next stage is for some random reason a snow level. Freezing Fun is this stage, and... yeah, come on. Well, as long as I don't die, I'm not going to care. But yeah, this game kind of has this tendency to just randomly swift around between aesthetics in the levels. Therefore not really getting a feel for the overworld. It does do it in most cases, but there's these random levels that don't really feel like they belong in certain worlds every once in a while, like this freezing level. The world itself is called Gangplank Galleon Ahoy, I believe, and is supposed to represent a jungle where we go towards the Gangplank Galleon. Remember that? King K. Rool's ship. It's called the Gangplank Galleon. It's also present here, of course. Since King K. Rool is also, once again, the bad guy, even though technically you might say it is Cranky, because Cranky is the one who hired him this case, because he was not convinced about the Kong's adventure last time. He said it was only because of it being on a fancy modern system. That's the reason we're back in the field again, you might say. And I'm getting hit a lot. Because I have the tendency to think this game is Donkey Kong Country. It looks like it a lot, but it definitely does not feel like it. I'll get used to it. Even though I'm probably only going to record 2 episodes and then record the next ones 1 week later and still not being able to get used to it. Okay, most of the levels have 1 or 2 bonuses, like always. And of course I'm going for 100% in this game. Just like in Donkey Kong Country, collecting the Kong letters is not required for 100%. In this case, it only helps you save your game, so collect them for that reason. It's basically the only thing you can do with them here. They don't give you 1-ups like in Donkey Kong Country. The 1-ups are actually displayed by the hearts. I completely forgot to talk about that. But the hearts you see at the bottom of the screen, those are the 1-ups in this game. So you can count the number of hearts and therefore see how... Oh, I thought I died there. Therefore, you can see how many lives you have. There's no separate counter for it in this game. Usually I am able to overflow that counter pretty early on in this game, whenever I play through it. Okay, end of stage. Yeah, I'm hurrying my way through this game, because in all honesty, this is a game that needs to be covered quickly, I think. It is a game I own, and therefore deserves to be covered. But it's also a game I don't really like to put too much time in. Because in all honesty, I think this game is not a very good rendition of what the original Donkey Kong Country is. Level-wise, I can definitely appreciate this game. It's a fun platformer and the challenges in it are fun to do. Like finding these secrets over here in the trees, for instance. However, I do not really agree on how Rare just revamped their graphics. They completely ripped their graphics from the SNES Donkey Kong Country and downscaled them and implemented them here. I don't really think that was a great idea, because in all honesty, in 8-bit on the Game Boy, I don't think these graphics look too awesome. They are really hot looking on the SNES. There it was really groundbreaking, but here on the Game Boy it does not come out too well. Okay, here's another one of these patches for an easy bonus. Don't worry, I'll be talking about gameplay and levels and what is going on a little bit more in later parts, I think. Now I have way too many things to talk about, because it is the first part. Oh, should have had that one up. I'm pretty sure I grabbed that, but nope, the game says no. And I'm not going to dispute that I got hit there. A lot of hits so far, but still no deaths. And yeah, unlike Donkey Kong Country, no One Kong challenge in this game. This is the only time I'm going to play through this game. Like I said, I am not the biggest fan of this game. I do really like it, but it's also a little bit... It also goes a little bit too far to say that I really love this game. Here's the end and a bonus, by the way. In case you're still following on. Oh, these are the bonuses that you actually use your tokens for, your Kong tokens. All of the Kong tokens you have collected, you can shoot out of this barrel by pressing this button. And whenever you are able to collect one, it gets translated into a 1-up, as you can see. This is what you're collecting the Kong tokens for. And trust me, I'm going to say Tong tokens a lot. Me am breaking over words. It is what I'm here for. Nothing up here? I was pretty sure there was... I was pretty sure Banana Bunch would have been hidden up there. Anyway, that was level 3. Quick little peek what that level is called, because the game forgets to do so. Simeon Swing, apparently. Yes, I am using a list that says all the level names, because why not? Okay, the first obstacle we meet on the overworld. As you can see, there are a couple of rocks here that block our path to the east and to the south. No way to get past that. But there's still one level to do here, on the ship. The Gangplank Galleon, you might say. At least I'm going to assume it's the Gangplank Galleon. First go to the left for a little bit of a secret. No bonus, but it does give you a couple of tokens and a 1-up, so... might as well pick those up. It does play the music for the Gangplank Galleon, so... yeah, and it's not just the graphics that they ripped from Donkey Kong Country in order to make this game. They also ripped the music. And, also has a little bit of a beautiful 8-bit rendition. That I definitely can appreciate, because 8-bit music I've always really been a fan of, so I can really appreciate whenever a tune gets played in 8-bit music. I can not say any bad words for that. And this song also sounds pretty neat. And gather all the stuff up here. And this aesthetic in Donkey Kong Land really reminds me of Donkey Kong Country 2, because all these rigging levels, like the aesthetic is officially called, that are in the masts of the ships, those are a recurring aesthetic in Donkey Kong Country 2. But Donkey Kong Country 2 is actually not the game that made that up, because this game became before it, and this game already has them. And that's what I can really appreciate in Donkey Kong Land. I've been saying a couple of bad things about it. There's also a couple of good things I can say about it. Namely, that this really feels like an original game. Even though it uses a lot of the mechanics from Donkey Kong Country, it is still an original game with its own aesthetics, its own little mechanics, its own level designs. And this is the only Donkey Kong Land game that does that, because Donkey Kong Land 2 and 3, the ones that are rebuilt after Donkey Kong Country 2 and 3, those two actually really try to mimic their country counterparts, even in the level design. Donkey Kong Land 2 and 3 really try to recreate the levels from 2 and 3. So those two games really feel like ports more. This game does not feel like a port, because it has all of these original levels. There's not a single level here that is from Donkey Kong Country. They're all original made levels, and that I really appreciate on this game. Something that the second and third part of Donkey Kong Land don't have, because those just copy Donkey Kong Country 2 and 3. But still, we're on the Game Boy Color, by the way. You can see there's a little bit of color. It is not the Super Game Boy version or color hack I'm playing. Every once in a while we need to appreciate the original styles these games were meant to be presented in, so for this game I decided to play on the Game Boy Color, so there's still a little bit of color, but no real coloring in. I think in this game that would have come out even worse. These original graphics feel a little bit better than what some coloring in might have do, because I'm pretty sure in 8-bit that would come out even worse than this. Okay, the N and the G are in the same bonus here, so if you want to save your game after this level, make sure you do this bonus. Not really hard to find, because it's in plain sight, most of the barrels in these early levels. For hidden bonuses, you need to wait until later in the game. And for now, I will try to gather all of the KONGs in all of the levels. I cannot guarantee that I'm able to do so. If I do not, I'm not going to care, because it's not required. But anyway, if you have beaten that level, you are given a bomb. Don't know where you get it from, because the game doesn't really tell you you have it. But you can blow up one of these rocks, as you can see. The second one we cannot blow up. So you can choose which level you can play next. I'm going to do this one, because why not? Okay, we have another random snow level, even though this world has nothing to do with snow, but Rare still wanted their quote-unquote ice levels in this game as well. There's no separate ice world in this game, so it's probably the reason why some of them got distributed randomly over some of the worlds. This one is heavily based on these rope climbing that we need to do. We know that from the original Donkey Kong Country. There's a couple of challenges involving these ropes in this level. Okay, the zingers don't look too nice. And for good reason, because if you touch them, you die. Those are the main obstacles you're given. Here a little bit of a barrel section. Automatically shot, so you need to time that correctly. And watch for this barrel at the bottom. There's a bonus here. Don't forget that. It is in plain sight, but you do need to look to the bottom closely, because you can overlook it. Especially since the graphics in this game does not always make it too clear where everything is. A keen eye is needed, and you're thrown into the checkpoint. You don't miss anything. That's just the end of the rope section we are thrown out. It's not like we skip half the level. Like Donkey Kong Country sometimes does. Not in this case. Okay, but I do believe there's another bonus in this level. In fact, we can see a barrel down here. See? If you look closely. The ones that are really mean are the ones you can't see, that are basically off-screen, that you actually need to guess where they are. In these early levels, they really are not that big meanies yet. They keep the barrels hidden, but not too hidden. They're still inside, so you can still see them, if you look closely. Oh, oops. Death number one. Every single project I start, one of my main goals whenever I do the first part is try not to die in the first part. I can turf one more at the category mission failed. Not that it matters too much. That was an example of barrel shot failure. With the spinning barrels, you do need to time when to get shot. If you're too early or too late, you'll get shot in a different direction, and that mostly means death. Not always, sometimes you can salvage a little bit, but in this case, you're down. That was what I was supposed to do, and don't go into this exit yet, because there's actually some stuff behind it. Game thinks it's funny. It's nothing more than bananas, and after that you get another exit. This is not a hidden secret exit or anything. For some reason, Rare just thought, player's probably too lazy to walk back, so let's put another exit here. But okay, that is another level done. We can continue with this one, or we can do the other level we skipped because of these rocks we couldn't blow up. It's still 100% playthrough after all. We're doing all of these levels. So this one too. Might as well go in. Okay, there's something up here. I'm pretty sure there is. If a ledge is still visible, then the game has hidden something there. Rule number one in a platformer. Okay, this is... Oh, this is a bonus, actually. I thought that was the way up there. But still, I also need those, so I'm not going to complain. This is another one of these token shops, I always call them for some reason, because this is the only place in the game where you can actually spend your tokens. By pressing the button and hope you gather your token back, giving you a 1-up. Which I've already overflown, by the way, number of 1-ups. Okay, if I am in a nice mood, I might put up a counter of how many lives you actually have, because that's another thing I can talk about. I'm getting hit stupidly by an army because of me rolling too late. Ah, Donkey Kong is stronger. He can kill the armies in one hit. But anyway, where was I? About the lives. In this game, there's not really a maximum number of lives, even though the screen overflows at some point, as you can see. The number of hearts does not fit in the screen anymore, but the game does keep counting them. The moment you die, you don't actually... Oh, there's a lot of tokens here. I think the next barrel bonus, I'm going to be happy. Me in editing is not going to be, because I'm going to have to keep track of all those 1-ups I'm going to collect. But yeah, the screen might overflow the number of lives I have, which are displayed in the number of hearts you see. But the game actually does have a counter of its own, and the number of lives actually still gets tallied up, even though the screen cannot handle them anymore. And yes, I know that for certain. That has been tested out by myself and by others. Number of lives keep counting, even though the screen does not count them anymore. And I come on. Oh, I did not have a Donkey Kong. I was pretty sure I did, but yeah, if you have no extra Kong, even though you can't really see him on screen because of the memory limitations, they immediately bonjour him out of the screen. But if you have no Kong in reserve and you get hit, then you automatically die, of course. There's no difference. But you don't always die immediately, because if you have an extra Kong in reserve, you simply switch to that other Kong. Even though I am uncertain how you're supposed to know you have an extra Kong. Yeah, you can switch by pressing select, I believe. Might try that out next time. Usually I never use that, actually, because switching Kongs is not really necessary. There's no things a Donkey can do that Diddy can't do, or the other way around, so it's not really necessary to switch. But I'm pretty sure it is possible. But anyway, 21 minutes is enough to stop for now. This has been part 1 for Donkey Kong Land. I know a lot of ramble from me. Hopefully that will be a little bit less next time, because most of the things have been explained by now. But the first couple of easy levels have been done. Next time we will finish Gangplank Galleon Ahoy World 1, hopefully. It's a long world, but hopefully we'll finish it next time. See you folks tomorrow for that. Treecks out!